Hello everybody. So today speaker is Veronica Lucky from the University of Siena, and she is going to talk about machine learning program, hot trends and emerging frontiers. So you can start.
Thank you. So, as I said before, thank you very much to all the organizers for having invited me here today. And today I will talk about machine learning for graphs, which are the hot trends and the emerging frontiers of this field. So, many applications, many research fields deal with data that present a structure that is not Euclidean. So, for example, social network in computational social sciences, or meshed surfaces in computer graphics, network sensors in communications, and also some kind of functional network for brain imaging. And a lot of these applications deal with a lot of data, and so very complex data and large amount of data. And so they are like natural targets for deep learning techniques. We have that deep learning techniques deal with the most famous deep learning techniques deal with regular structured data, like for example, regular grid, like images, vectors, and something like that. And so there is this field, this subfield of deep learning that is geometric deep learning that instead work with graph structured data. And the most famous algorithm for geometric deep learning are graph neural networks. And the story of geometric deep learning and graph neural network is quite long. So we have traced back of some of the most recent, the most old works about graph neural network are in the mid of 90s. But we can say that the most interesting works are from the last few years. And in the last years, graph neural networks have become one of the hottest topics in deep neural networks. Like, for example, you can see some statistic of keywords used in ICLR abstract. So ICLR is one of the most important conferences about deep learning. And unfortunately, I was able to find just the statistics 2020, but I'm sure that in the last 3 years it was more or less the same. And so you can see that the number of graph neural network words in this abstract is quite a lot, and it's increasing in time. And more interesting, you can see that starting from the beginning of machine learning on graph, also the number of papers with the name graph in the title on archive has grown very fast. And so we can see that, okay, we don't know what will happen in future, but right now is one of the most important topics in deep learning. But of course, there are also some drawbacks, some problems in the use of graph neural network for learning graph structured data. So let's see, let's start by see how graph neural network works. So the main goal of graph neural network is that of learn informative and expressive representation of the nodes of the graph, and more in general, also of the whole graph. And they do so with a sort of a local computational mechanism, which is called message passing mechanism. So you can start from this input graph that can or also cannot have feature in the node. And so suppose that you are interested in computing the representation of a certain node I, and suppose that you have some feature in the node. So you start by highlighting what is called the computational graph, which is a subgraph of the original graph, which is composed by the central node for which you want to calculate the representation, and all the first order neighborhoods of the node. Then you, as I said before, the mechanism of the message passing is like local computational mechanism. So you start by aggregating the feature of the neighborhood of the node. So you have this feature of the first order neighborhood. You use some kind of aggregation function, and the important thing is that this aggregation function must be a permutation invariant function, because in the computational graph, the neighborhoods nodes don't have an order. Okay, so it doesn't matter if this node came before or the other node. So the function must be a permutation invariant function. Then you use this kind of message produced by the aggregation function, in order to combine this message with the original node feature. So you combine the node feature with the message and you obtain a final representation of the node. This is an iterative mechanism. So you start with this local computation in one layer, and then usually graph neural network is composed by stacking several message passing layer, and so you iterate this procedure until a certain depth that you can decide. So it happens that at the end, so when you arrive at the L layer, you have that the representation of the node is able to contain the information related to the L op neighborhood of the node. And as I said before, you can stack several message passing layers together. And one important thing is that each message passing layer must be permutation invariant. So the aggregation must be permutation invariant. The message passing layer, the whole message passing layer must be equivariant. So if you change the order of the nodes, the metrics that you will have at the end must have the same permutation of the rows, okay? Because you have to like keep trace of the identity of the nodes during the message passing operations. When you arrive at the end, you can use the final representation at a certain layer L in order to use it as an input for a readout function. And in this way, you can obtain the final output that can then be used for some node level tasks, like, for example, node classification, node regression, and so on and so forth. You can also maybe be interested in having some representation for the whole graph, as I said before. And so in this case, you have to find a way to sum up all the information of all the nodes in the graph into a unique vector representation. And so you can use some global pooling that can be like, for example, global sum or min, max, whatever you want, in order to put together all this information. And then you can use this representation, this unique vector representation, as input of a readout function in order to have a global embedding of the whole graph. And then you can use this for graph level tasks like graph classification, graph regression, and so on. Of course, as I said before, this aggregation and combine function can be whatever. So the important thing is that the aggregation must be permutation invariant, but you can use some kind of attention mechanism, you can use some sort of injective function. Depending on the different formulation of the combine and aggregation function, you can have several different kind of graph neural networks. And of course, the aggregation, the combine, and the readout function are parametric functions. So there are some parameters that you learn from the data. And in modern graph neural network, these parameters are different in each different layer. So, as I said before, a lot of different graph neural networks model exist. How can we distinguish between these existing models? How can we evaluate this model? So, there are a lot of theoretical problems of graph neural networks. And so a great effort has been dedicated during the last few years in order to study all these kind of theoretical problems of graph neural network. And one of the most studied problems of graph neural network is that of the expressive power of graph neural network. What does it mean, expressive power? So it's important to study which kind of graph can the GNN distinguish. So for which kind of graph the GNN is able to produce a different output. And as you can imagine, this problem is strictly related to the graph isomorphism problem. And so the expressive power of graph neural network has been studied by comparing the power of graph neural network, the capabilities of graph neural network, to those of the standard algorithm for testing the graph isomorphism. And one of the most famous algorithms for testing the graph isomorphism is the Pascal-Lemann test, which is an iterative algorithm that tests whether two graphs are not isomorphic. So you start from two graphs. You want to see if two graphs are isomorphic or not. Maybe you have some feature in the node, or maybe you can also not have feature in the node. Like in this example, there are no features in the node. And you start by coloring each node with a color, thanks to an injective function, a hash function, that takes as input the initial feature and gives us as output a color. And then each iteration, you update the color of each node based on the previous color of the node and on the colors of the neighborhoods of the node. And so, as you can see, here are some iterations of this Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann algorithm. And the algorithm finishes when it reaches convergence. So when the distribution of the colors doesn't change between two iterations. At the end, you will compare the two distribution of colors. If the two distribution of colors are different, then you can say that for sure these two graphs are not isomorphic. If the distribution of the colors are equals, you can say that the graph are possibly isomorphic. So having this distribution of colors equal is a necessary but not sufficient condition for two graphs to be isomorphic. So it has been proved that GNNs with appropriate formulation of aggregation and combined functions are as powerful as this Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test. And here there is the iterative algorithm that produces this kind of injective function. So if you use this kind of equation for calculating the representation of the node, then you will end up in a graph neural network that is as powerful as the Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test. What is the problem? That, as I said before, is the Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test is a necessary but not sufficient condition for the graph isomorphism. So there are some failures of Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test and of course also some failures of graph neural networks. So for example, this is a very famous example of two graphs and that are different, so they are not isomorphic, but the Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test fails in distinguish between them. And as a consequence, also graph neural network will end up in different representation for these two graphs. And this can be a problem because we can say that in this sense, graph neural networks are not like universal approximators. So they cannot approximate any function. They can approximate any function modulo the limit imposed by the Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test. And so this can be a problem. So a lot of studies try to find a way to increase this expressive power of graph neural network. And so one of the most famous way of increasing the expressive power of graph neural network is that of going higher order. So using higher order structure within the message passing mechanism. So instead of using just the first order neighbors of the node, you use some higher order structure like tuple in the graph. And in these ways, you can construct a sort of hierarchical GNN. Every GNN is more powerful than the lower GNN, but the problem is that this kind of message passing algorithm is high, it has a high computational cost. And so other methods have been proposed. One other method is that of encoding multiset of subgraphs instead of multiset of node. So the intuition is that, okay, well, these two graphs, so if you take the example of before, you can see that they contain different subtraction. So just by looking at them, you can see that the first contains squares and the second graph contains triangles. And so in some way, if you consider subgraphs of the original graph, you are able to distinguish between them. And so this new method basically just construct bugs of subgraphs and then perform Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test in these bags of subgraphs, and then at the end you will end up with, let's say, a more complicated Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test, a more, also in this case, computational high cost Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test, but you are able to distinguish between these two kind of graphs. A final possibility is that of incorporating random features into the nodes. So this is quite intuitive. So let's suppose that you start from these two not isomorphic graphs, but unfortunately, Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test will end up with the same output. If you inject some random feature in the node, since the Evans-Ferrer-Lehmann test and also the graph neural network considers also the feature of the node in a bijective way, then you are able to distinguish between these two graphs. Unfortunately, there are some generalization problems with this approach. So generalization capability of graph neural network means the capability of performing well also on unseen data. And if you use this kind of trick for increasing the expressive power of GNN, it's possible that, okay, the performances are good in the training, but they are not so good in the test set. And so basically you end up with some generalization problems. So this is a real active field research. So the research is still ongoing on this. And so we need some new algorithm that in some way is able to increase the performances, the expressive power of graphical network, maintaining low computational cost. And it's also, I think, very interesting to study to deepen the relationship between the performances in several tasks and the expressive power of graphical network, because the study on this like relationship between performances and expressive power is not that clear. And so I think that this can be also interesting to study these kind of things from a theoretical point of view. There are some other theoretical properties of graphical network, and one of the most theoretical problem of graphical network is the problem of the so-called oversmoothing. So one important aspect of deep neural network is, as the name suggests, the depth of the neural network, so the number of layers in the neural network. And it has been proved that for most of the most famous deep learning algorithms, like the convolutional neural network for images, and also for MLP, so for multilayer perceptron, the depth of the neural network is strictly related to the performances of the neural network. So increasing the number of layers in the neural network can lead to a better performances in the final task. This not also for graphical network, and it's in some way the opposite. So maybe you are interested in having deeper graphical network, because as said before, increasing the number of layers means reaching farther nodes. Okay, so in the first layer you have the information of the first order neighborhood, in the second layer the second order neighborhood, and so on and so forth. So in order to have a global vision of the graph, you may are interested in having a lot of layers, so at least also until the diameter of the graph. But unfortunately, it has been proved that the performances of the GNN are lower as you increase the number of layers. And so in real experiments, you have some kind of real shallow graphical network, so basically also just three or four layers. This is because increasing the number of layers, you end up with this oversmoothing phenomenon. So the representation of the node will go to the same representation. So as the number of layers increase, this embedding of the node becomes more and more similar to the layers. And so this can seem in some way in contrast to the expressive power that I told before, because I said before, if you use some expressive graphical network, you are able to distinguish graphs. But the problem is that, okay, maybe you have some injecting function, but this function, even if it is injective, it can in some way reduce the distance between the node representation. And so as you increase the number of layers, you will end up in a matrix of representation that is composed by the same vectors. Okay, so you have also some visual representation. You start with the node features that are equal, sorry. Then with the first method passing, you are able to distinguish between them. But then if you continue with this method passing layer, you will end up with the same node feature. And mathematically, we can formulate this phenomenon in this way. So you have like the convergence of a certain measure of similarity between the feature node. And some solutions have been proposed. One solution can be that of using some residual connection. So as said before, when you perform a stage passing, every time you combine the feature of the previous layer with the feature of the neighborhoods node, with residual connection, you can use in every message passing operation also the feature of the initial layers. And in this way, it has been proved that this problem of oversmoothing is some way mitigated. You can use also some regularization or normalization method, where normalization, I mean, okay, as I said before, these vector representation are closer and closer. You can normalize these in some way and try to keep them a little bit far from each other. Or you can do some regularization. So basically, in the training procedure, you can impose some constraint on the loss function in order to avoid these kind of problems. And you can also try to change in some way the formulation of the message passing in order to have something different, because it's a problem of the message passing in itself. And so a lot of different solutions have been proposed during the last year, but it's still an ongoing field of research because yeah, we can do better this, we can solve better this problem over smoothing. Another problem strictly related to the depth of the neural network is the so-called over-squashing problem. So sometimes you are interested in some real case application to learn the representation of a node, and you know that the representation of this node depends on a node that is quite far from the node itself. And this can be a problem if you have some kind of graph structure where you have this kind of bottleneck. So you have that the neighborhood, the order of the neighborhoods increase exponentially with the opening. And in this case, you can have that the information related to a certain node is like it cannot pass through this bottleneck. And in some way, it fails to reach the other node. And some solutions have been proposed for this problem. And one of the most famous one is that of graph rewiring. So you have to slightly modify the structure of the graph, like, for example, adding some edges in order to reduce this bottleneck. And reducing this bottleneck allow all the information from a certain community to flow also in the other communities, and in some way you don't have any more this over-squashing problem. So the problem of this information that is blocked in some part of the graph. But also in this case, also the relationship between over-squashing and over-smoothing are still not well studied, and so we have to deepen the theoretical aspects of these kind of problems. And I think that there are a lot of possibility to apply some geometrical, also differential geometry or something like that tool in order to solve this kind of problems. So another directions, research directions of graph neural network in the last year is that of extending graph neural network to other graph type, because as you know, there are a lot of different type of graphs. And one of the most interesting applications or most application interesting extension is the extension of graph neural network to dynamic graphs. So as you know, a lot of graphs are dynamic in nature. So the first problem is that of defining, so find a correct definition, a correct formalization of temporal graphs. So one of the most important distinctions is between a snapshot-based graph, which are basically a stacking of static graphs in time, and event-based graph, where we can represent each graph as a stream of or events, like adding an age, removing an age, changing of the feature of the node, and so on. And another important aspect is that with temporal graph, you can have several different tasks. So for example, you may be interested in predicting a future link between two users in a social network, or maybe also to predict a future link between two unseen users, two new users in a social network. Or maybe you can also be interested in understand if in the past one person was infected by COVID-19 and you don't know it. So in order to maybe try to understand the contagion network. So there are different kind of learning problems. So both we can learn something about the future or about the past, and both in a transductive and inductive way. So with transductive, I mean that the training is done with some kind of node and the testing is done in the same group of nodes. While with inductive learning, you can make inference also on unseen node. And so with temporal graph, this kind of distinction is quite difficult to understand. And it's difficult to understand also which kind of temporal graph neural network is able to perform both transductive and inductive learning. So there are a lot of new temporal graph neural network model. Basically, we can distinguish between graph neural network model that can learn the snapshot-based representation and the graph neural network model that learn the event-based representation. All of these graph neural network, temporal graph neural network, are characterized by different ways of learning the temporal aspect. So in the model evolution, you learn how to evolve the weights of the network in time. In the embedding evolution, you learn how to evolve the embedding of the node in time, while with the temporal embedding, you learn some kind of specific function of time, like Fourier transform or something like that. With the temporal neighborhood, you can learn, you have the sort of the same sort of message passing as I showed you before, but with explicit dependencies on time. So there are several kind of temporal graph neural networks, and as you can see, there are some holes in this taxonomy. So there are some particular kind of setting, so transactive, inductive, past and future settings that are not covered in literature. So there is a lot of possibility to try to formulate, to design new temporal graph neural networks that are specifically designed for solve this kind of problem. And this is a real open question that we can work on. So far I've talked about some theoretical aspects, and now I want to go a little bit more in some applications. So as you can imagine, there are a lot of applications for graph neural network, like for example, try to predict if a certain drug can have some side effects, or try to predict fake news, like fake news detection, or also some applications about recommender system, for example. I think that one of the most prominent applications of graph neural network is that of graph generation for drug design. So before I talk about some very like easy tasks that we can perform with graph neural network, like for example, node classification, node regression, or graph classification, and so on. But there is another task that is doable with the graph neural network, that is the graph generation task. So basically, with the graph generation task, I mean that you have a bunch of graphs, that is your dataset. You want to learn the distribution behind this dataset, and then you can generate new graphs starting from the distribution that you have learned. And so you can do this with several methods, but one of the most, I think, interesting application of this is that of the synthesis of new molecules and drugs. So why this is very interesting? Because it has been estimated that all the possible synthesizable molecules are a lot, like 10 to the power of 60. And so by experiments in like in lab, you can try to synthesize at most 10 to the power of 3. So quite a few molecules. And it's also a lot of very expensive. So try to develop new drugs in vitro, it's very, very expensive. So you can try to use something else, so some kind of some other methods, okay? So there are a lot of methods that have been proposed, but one of the best one is using GNN for generation, because it's one of the cheapest one, both in terms of money and in terms of computational cost. And it can, like with GNNs, it has been proved that you can generate also something like 10 to the power of 12 synthetic molecules. So during the last 2 or 3 years, a lot of different methods have been proposed for doing this. I just want to mention this, that is one of the newest methods that is proposed this year, which is called Chroma. It's quite difficult, all the machine learning stuff behind this method, but the important thing is that you can use some GNN-like method in order to generate graph. And you can use with this method also some, you can impose some functional and geometric constraints, and you can use also some natural language queries. So it's like you can use several different kind of machine learning techniques in order to get this pipeline that is able to produce in a very accurate way some new possible molecules for drug and so on. So some possible future direction for graph neural network. I think that one of the most important things from a theoretical point of view is that of having a better understanding of the generalization capability of GNN. So as I said before, I talk about expressive power, okay? Expressive power is strictly related to the approximation capability of GNN. So which kind of function can the GNN approximate? But there is another aspect of theoretical aspects of graphical network that is, as I said before, generalization. So which kind of, so the ability of GNN to perform well on unseen data. And for this point of view, there are not that many studies as for the expressive point of view. Another possible future direction is that of trying to dedicate more efforts on creating time and memory efficient subgraph GNN, because as I said before, subgraph GNN are quite promising also from an expressive point of view, but they are in some way not that efficient. And so we can try to have some better models in this case. We can try to use diffusion models and generative flow networks. There are some particular kind of generative deep learning methods for protein generation, so for drug generation and something like that. We can try also to improve the scalability of graph neural network, so to reduce the computational cost and also the inference time for very large graphs. And okay, I think that it would be interesting also to have more applications in some very hot topics like climate modeling, weather forecasting, also spreading of epidemics, but this is more studied, but maybe for climate modeling, graph neural network are not that studied yet. And okay, at the end, we can also, I think that it will be interesting and it's a promising area for GNN studies, that of learning dynamical system through the combination of graph neural network and physical knowledge. So, for example, there exists this physics informed graph neural network, and there have been some attempts to expand this physics informed graph neural network also to graphs, but we can do more, so it's just at the beginning. So I think that it can be useful to introduce also some knowledge, maybe physical knowledge, inside graph neural network also to have some maybe also more interpretable stuff. So for the technical part, I've done, and thank you very much, and if you have any questions, I'm glad to answer.
Yes. There are any questions from the audience? I have one myself, two actually.
Yes.
So thank you very much for the talk. It was super interesting.
Thank you.
One question is, I lost how the color changed in the WL test.
Yes, okay, I can go. Okay, so you start from here. So suppose that you have uniform colors in the nodes between the two graphs, okay? So at the beginning, so at the first iteration, you assign to each node a color based on its feature, okay? So at the beginning, you will have yellow color for each node, because suppose that you don't have feature, okay? You have a uniform feature, okay? So at the beginning, just you injectively assign a color to a node. Then at each iteration, you update this color with still a injective function that have as argument the previous color. So for example, take the node one. At the second iteration, this hashing function takes as input yellow colors and the colors of the neighborhoods. So node one have as the neighbors 3, 4, and 2. So it has 3 neighbors of yellow colors. And so you will have the same colors of 3, because also 3 is yellows, and it has 3 neighbors of yellow colors. Okay, so at the second iteration, 1 and 3 will have the same colors, while 2, 4, and 5 will have the same colors, because they all have yellow as color at the beginning, and they all have just 2 neighbors of the same color. Okay, is it clear? And then you keep going. So you start again, you take node one, he has the green color, and he has, of course, 3 neighbors, 2 yellow neighbors and 1 green neighbors. And so you have this injective function of basically green, yellow, yellow, green. And so it will become red. and so on, until the distribution of the colors don't change in time in the iterations. Is it clear now? I can't hear
Yeah,
you.
it is.
Okay. Maybe I will have to put some formulas on this slide to make it clear, more clear.
No, but it's okay. I just the connection stopped at some
Okay.
point and I lost the description. Okay, so you use this test to
Yeah.
actually to well solve try to solve the isomorphism problem, no?
Yes,
Between the two.
yes. Yes, of course, it's
And
you
this
cannot. Sorry, yes.
and this is the base of the GNN.
Yes,
I
let's
mean.
say that they work at the same way. So also GNN, the mechanism of GNN is very similar because also GNN have this iterative algorithm to calculate to calculate the representation of the node. And you calculate the representation of the node based on the feature of the neighborhood node and on the feature of the node itself. So basically, they work in the same way. And that's why they have the same power in distinguished graphs.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the second question was in this direction, that is,
Yeah.
how does the GNN perform in terms of computational time and accuracy? In comparison with other classical algorithms to compute the to solve the isomorphisms problem.
Yeah, okay, so with respect to this algorithm is the same. They are as powerful, they have the same expressive power basically. And usually when you are trying to increase this expressive power, so many of the studies that try to increase the expressive power works like this. So you try to define a new test for graph isomorphism, okay? And then you try to design a GNN that mimic the way of working of this new algorithm, okay? So for example, with this higher order GNN, first of all, they design a higher order Pasquale Lehmann test, which is based not on the neighborhoods, but on tuple of nodes. And then they construct a new method passing algorithm that considers not neighborhoods, but tuple of nodes. So basically you start by defining a new graph isomorphism test, which is hopefully more powerful than the Pasquale Lehmann test. And then you try to to design a GNN that works like this algorithm. Of course, there are some computational cost problems. So you, as I said before, in this case, okay, the test is more powerful, but if you try to construct a GNN that works like that, it's very heavy from a computational cost point of view.
Just very last question, and then
Yes.
Silvia can speak because I can see your eyes here. Maybe too many questions. Anyway.
No.
No, the fact is that at the beginning you said you we can end up with a vector that represents the graph
Yeah.
and put the graph in a space. So my question is, if there are two graphs, always connected with the isomorphism problem, if there are two graphs that are close together in this space, is this related to the real distance, like a graph edit distance, for example,
Okay,
between
yes.
the two graphs, or is another space? I mean,
no, Allora, so if the GNN works well, it has to in some way preserve the distance. So you want this vector representation to be closer if the two graphs are similar and not that closer if these two graphs are not similar. This is not related to the Pasquale-Lehmann test because the output of the Pasquale-Lehmann test is just yes or not. So it's not like you cannot calculate this. But with other kind of distance, it's you hope that if the graph neural network works well, you have this kind of preserving distance function, okay?
Okay, super. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Silvia, you had a question
Yes.
or
Yeah, I have like
no?
a curiosity.
Yes.
At some point you talk about the problem of generalization
Yes.
when you try to like optimize, if I understood correctly, if you try to optimize the graph neural network in this isomorphic quest by
Yes.
adding random nodes, right?
Yes.
Yeah, this one.
No,
Could you?
random node features. So it's
Okay, random features, okay.
yes.
Could you explain more what does it mean, the problem of generalization? Because,
Yes.
yeah.
Okay, so when you evaluate the performances of a deep neural network in general, you can evaluate the performances on two different things. So you can evaluate the performances on the training set, so the data set on which you train your neural network. And then you can evaluate the neural network on a test set, which is like a sort of new set that composed by data that your models hasn't seen before, okay? So these two performances can be different. So you can have very high performances in the training set and low performances in the test set, for example, because in some case there is this overfitting problem. So the neural network is learning the structure of the data, but just this data. So it's not able to generalize to other data. And so sometimes the training accuracy, so the performances, can be very high, okay? But then if you try your neural network with some unseen data, you have lower performances. And so it has been proved that with this kind of solution for increasing the expressive power of graph neural network, you can end up with some, okay, they said that it's better from an expressive point of view, okay? Maybe this model can have also some good performances in the training phase, okay? But when you try this model on unseen graph, you will end up with very poor performances. I hope that this is clear now.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, there are questions. No.
Hi, I have a question.
Hi.
Do you have an intuition which direction to follow to test properly these graph neural networks? So, for example, I know that there are big issues with the network reconstruction. So, to reproduce probabilistically what you have input as a graph. But graph neural network are still used to do some recommendation systems for social network or Netflix and other stuff. Do you have an intuition which problem is the best to be solved such that then we can say the graph neural network will be reliable?
Okay, so. Well, actually, this is one of the questions that I want to also ask you after with the discussion. So I feel that for some kind of task, it's still better to use some traditional methods or some other methods and not graph neural network, deep learning methods. So I think that, and I also want to know from you what you think about which kind of task it's better to use a graph neural network, or which kind of tasks are more suitable for other kind of methods. As far as I know from my studies, for like the standard problems when you have a lot of clean good data for node classification and node regression, and also graph classification and regression, graph neural networks are quite good. While for generation And for reconstruction, graph neural network are not that good, maybe also with, so I think that for generation is one of the weakness of graph neural network. So for sure, I think that not generation, and so for generation, we have to do something more maybe. And also for reconstruction, but maybe so for node level tasks like prediction or classification at node level, they are quite good.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Shall we go to the second? Can we switch to the discussion part if you want?
Yeah. So, okay. So I wanted to talk about machine learning for graphs versus complex systems analysis. So basically, I'm more expert on machine learning on graphs. Some of you know that I tried also to make some work about computational social systems or something like that. So in theory, I'm also working on this, but I'm not that expert on this. But well, I've also attended some conferences that are more from the world of network science or something like that. And I've always been fascinated by also this world. And so my curiosity is that, okay, well, I think that machine learning for graphs and complex systems analysis have more or less the same general goal, that is that of extract informative information, good information from complex structured data. And so my questions were, okay, in which case you prefer to use some kind of approach with respect to another approach? And which are the problems of machine learning for graphs that can in some way be solved by complex systems, standard complex systems tools? So which are point of contact between these two fields, and if I feel that somehow it's like a very separated field, from the like community point of view, but I think that we can merge a little bit these two communities. And so I'm wondering how we can try to find a point of contact and try to integrate these two approaches in order to have also better results and more good models or something like that. So I think that one of the biggest problem for machine learning for graphs is that of explainability, interpretability. So I haven't talked about this in the talk because I'm not that expert about this, but it's quite known that deep learning methods have this problem of explainability, and for graphs this is also even more complicated to solve with respect to other deep learning methods. And I think that instead for some complex systems analysis tool, you can have some explanation about what you have at the end of the task. And also some maybe scalability problems. So for this kind of machine learning tools, we have this problem that if you learn your model with small data, then you have to ensure that you can also perform well on very graph data. We have some computational cost problem, some problem because in many applications you want supervisions, and in many cases you don't have these supervisions. And you can also have some problem in finding large amount of clean data that are necessary for machine learning for graphs. And I think that maybe some of this problem can be solved if you use some complex systems analysis tools instead of machine learning for graphs. So since I'm also not that expert on this, I want also to see your point on this and to find a way to integrate these two communities.
This is a really hard task. Well, who? What do you think about the advancing that you feel, or which is, according to you, more advanced? And I mean, advanced towards the goal that is to extract information from complex data.
What, sorry?
What do you think? Which of the two fields is more advanced towards the goal? I mean, is more close to the goal of extracting information from complex data? Also. This is the question.
Okay, I don't know. I think that, as we said before, maybe it depends a lot on the task and on the different kind of data that you have. So maybe for some task, machine learning for graph is better, and you can achieve better performances, maybe also with some less effort, let's say. But for other tasks, maybe we still need something else. I don't think that machine learning for graph is like the solution for this problem. Instead, I think that there are a lot of problems. So also in my talk before, I try to highlight the problem that machine learning for graph has. So really, I don't know which one is the best, but I think that it depends on the problem and on the kind of data or something like that. And of course, as I said before, for example, the problem of explainability is quite a good point, because maybe if you have to work with some company, you have to give some explanation for which you have taken some decision or something like that. And so maybe using this kind of other approach is better than using machine learning for graphs, because in this case, you cannot give some explanation for your decision, for your final decision.
Yeah, I mean, the part of explainability is, I mean, it's a bit of a general problem, the fact that it's the longest-standing fight between machine learning and, theoretical analysis, no?
Yeah.
So the fact of explainability is a good compromise between the two. I think that, and from the opinion I get from the people from the many conferences, is that if you can explain it, then it's closer to what we do.
Yeah. Yes. Of course. Yes. Yeah, I totally agree. And I think that, of course, also for practical aspects, it's one of the biggest problems of deep learning in general, yes, and also for machine learning for graphs. And
Silvia, you
No, I just wanted to add that I also believe that it's related to the system you are trying to analyze, because maybe some systems is more efficient to use like a machine learning approach, because of, I don't know, because it's more natural, or maybe some stuff happening on the system that is more like useful and easy to describe through like a machine learning approach. But maybe there are some other systems or some other, I don't know, dynamics that are more difficult to grasp through a machine learning approach, and you need some kind of complex system analysis tools or like networkish stuff and stuff like that.
Yeah, I want to ask to answer to the question of Nelson, that asked if something about temporal community detection. And I tried a lot to study temporal graph neural networks, and as far as I know, there are no works on this kind of temporal community detection with graph neural networks. And so I think that, of course, we can do something about this and it can be interesting, but it's a completely new field. So, of course, it can be interesting to try to find some clustering methods within the graph that depends on the also on the temporal aspects. And so not just using community detection within a snapshot, but try to learn the temporality with something else. And so, yeah, but there are no graph neural network, temporal graph neural network methods specifically made for this kind of task. And so it's a good point for future work. Okay, sorry for having interrupted, but I wanted to answer to this question.
There is another question from the audience. Yes. Go on.
Can I make a question?
Yeah.
Have you ever worked with the hyperbolic node embedding? Because I've seen there are many attempts to embed the nodes in an embedding geometric space rather than Euclidean one.
Yeah, I have never worked with that, but I know them, and I was laughing because it's one of the next goal, try to deep this, because I'm interested in this also for the oversmoothing point of view, because since the problem is that you learn these representations that are very close in this space, okay? But if you use some kind of other space with other geometrical properties like hyperbolic space, maybe you can work for using this kind of output space for solving the oversmoothing problem or something like that. So I've never worked about that, but I think that I am quite promising. Also, there are a lot of work about try to use this differential geometry or something like that with GNN for improve something. And I think they are all quite good. And also hyperbolic graph neural network seems quite interesting. So I've never worked on this, but I want to, so let's see.
Okay, but do you think that changing geometry of the embedding space is more promising than maybe coarse graining the original network? So for example, you can obtain a simpler network while only considering communities, and so you are really pruning all the links that are at work in that kind of coarse grained network, and then fine grained your parameters towards the original network.
Okay. There is this also field of research that is the hierarchical pooling graph neural network. That is more or less what you have said so far. So try to find a way of reducing the dimension of the graph within the message passing procedures. Okay, and this can lead to better performances, and can also try to find a link with what I was saying before. With this pooling, you can somehow also reduce oversmoothing and something like that. For what concerns the hyperbolic graph neural network, I don't know. I think that there are quite different strategies. So maybe I don't know really how to compare these two things and say, okay, well, this is better than this. I think that are quite different. I don't know, because since I don't know well hyperbolic graph neural network, I cannot say if it's better or worse with respect to just coarser the graph and learning this coarser representation within the message passing. I don't know. I can try to study more and find some results on this.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you have in mind a paper speaking about hierarchical pooling?
Yes, of course, a lot. Okay, so there is this survey that is called I can check, I don't remember the name, but it's from this understanding pooling graphical networks. And so here you can find because there are several studies about this hierarchical pooling, and here you can find all the existing, so it's not it's like from I think 2020 or something like that, so maybe now there are also more methods, but you can find the most famous one here. And there is also a taxonomy of the existing hierarchical pooling method. So here you can have, because you can distinguish between hierarchical pooling method that just throw away some nodes in the graph that are the sparse method. Dense methods are methods that connect together, like community detection, sort of community detection. And so fixed pooling method that in which the number of nodes is fixed, it does not depend on the original number of nodes, and so on. So here you can find a lot of stuff. And I think that is the clearest way for learning something about hierarchical pooling. And it's quite interesting because, as I said before, you can use pooling in general, this kind of hierarchical pooling enable to have better performances in some task, graph-related task, okay? So learning this coarse representation of the graph within the network, you lose some information, but you retain the important information. So you learn how to learn the important information in a hierarchic way, and so you have better performances at the end. And so, and you can also solve some other problem like the oversmoothing problems, and you can also study, so I was talking about expressive power, so there are also some studies on expressive power of pooling, but also on how to increase the expressive power with pooling. So it's quite interesting to study these kind of things. Well, at least I'm interested in this, so yeah.
I put the link in the chat. I think it's the right paper, but maybe you should check.
Yes, it's the correct one. Yes.
Is this one?
Yes, yes, okay. Yes. But No, I just want to say, if you're interested in pooling in general, you can contact me because I'm working on this now, and so I'm I really love this kind of subject. And so if you want to ask me something more, you can ask me also later.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So unless there are any last minute questions, last opportunity? No? Okay, so I think we are done for today. Thank you very much, Veronica.
Thank
was
you.
Really interesting, and the discussion was very
thank you, Veronica.
Thank you.
So see you at the next seminar then, in 2 weeks.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.